lift your voice in worship. Come on, lift your voice. Lift your voice in worship. Oh, the Spirit of God is moving on those who worship. Somebody just wave those hands. We just honor your presence today. We just honor your presence tonight, Holy Spirit. That's all we really want, Lord, is just to be where you are. Just to be in your presence. We honor you. Praise is what I do. And I want to be close to you. Testimony in all that I go through. Somebody said, why? I said, because praise is what I do.
Stop! Up against the wall. Good morning. Thank you. First of all, good morning. How you doing this morning? I feel good. I don't know about you. I wasn't going to do the devotion this morning, but I was listening to that beautiful music. Then it say, praise is what I do. And what better thing to do than to praise our God and Savior, our Lord and Savior that gave his life for us. And I can do nothing better but to exonerate him on this Lord's Day. So we're going to start our devotional service. We're going to start off by singing hymn number 248, Hold to God's Unchanging Hands. That's always was a favorite of mine. I don't know if it's a favorite of yours, but it's one of my favorites, so we'll do that. Time is filled with trips, transition. None on earth a move can stand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hands. Hold to his hands, to God's unchanging hands. Hold to his hands, to God's unchanging hands. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hands. Trust in him who will not leave you. Whatsoever years may bring, if my earthly friends forsaken, still more closely to his hand. You just hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, God's unchanging hand. Fill your hope on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hands. Here's the hope. Cover not this world vain riches that so rapidly decay. Seek to gain a heavenly treasure. They will never pass away. Hold to his hands, to God's unchanging hands. You just hold to his hands, to God's unchanging hands. Fill your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hands. And this is the payoff. When your journey is completed, if to God you have been true, fair and bright the home in glory, you're enwrapped and so with you. You just hold to his hands, to God's unchanging hands. Just hold to his hands, to God's unchanging hands. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hands. It's love in his hands, God's unchanging hands. So much love in his hand, God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. You just hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Fill your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hands. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Thank you, Lord. hold to his hands. Hold to his hands. What a beautiful thing to do. Somebody said, I know you know that poem about a man was walking. He was walking with somebody. He thought he was walking with a friend and praying to the Lord. And all of a sudden, he saw two footsteps. He didn't know because he wanted to wonder why he saw his. He saw another footsteps beside him. He was going through some trouble. When he came down and asked the Lord, why did you come to me when I was in trouble? He said, you saw those extra footsteps beside you. That was me. So the Lord is always with us. We may not see him, but he's always with us all the time. All you have to do is call upon him. Praise God. Let us have prayer. Father God, in the precious name of Jesus, it's another Lord's day that you allowed us to see. And we thank you, Holy Father. We thank you for all that you've done to us. We thank you for bringing us to this place and time. The man may say that, who cares about me? Why should I do this? Why should I do that? I take care of me. Worry about me. I won't worry about nobody but me. But then the Lord says, if I had did that, you wouldn't be here. That's the purpose of those extra footsteps. Lord is always with us. So we should be looking toward one another. If you know a friend that have a problem, and if you can give any assistance at all, think about how you would feel if you were down on your luck and a friend came to you and say, hey man, no problem. What do you need? I give it to you. That's how the Lord is with us. He wants us to be that way toward others. Am I my brother's keeper? Yes. Somebody's keeping me every day. I don't know about most of you who know me. I lost my wife about 18 months ago, and I still haven't gotten over it. I don't think I ever get over it. I talk to her constantly when I have problems. I don't know if you ever lost a very dear loved one. I've been telling this story every day to people that I can help. So I was married to a wonderful woman for 54 years. 54 years. The first 3 years, if you know my wife, you know the first 3 years must have been rocky. But after that, everything was heaven. I stand here this morning thinking about her. Think about the Lord. Loved me so much that he gave me such a wonderful woman to go through life with me. You guys, you men that are married, treat your woman, not your woman, treat your wife, well, it is your woman and your wife, as you would want someone to treat you. Lord, I'm here today asking you to continually bless me and all that I do and everyone that come into my surroundings that I could help. Continually give me the power to help them. I know this is a prayer that should be for the congregation, but what better prayer is there that we look toward one another? We are our brother's keeper. If Jesus had not thought that way, we wouldn't be here today. He gave his life for us that we may continue on going and look toward what we can do to help someone beside ourselves. I feel good this morning. I don't know about you. But I feel good that I have the articulation of my speech and that I can still utter a prayer in need. Someone saw me talking to myself one time. I wasn't talking to myself. I was talking to the Lord. I was thinking him. And I also learned something. I'm not here to give testimony. I shouldn't be here giving testimony, so I'm just going to cut this short. If you see me walking around like I'm talking to someone, don't think that I'm crazy. I'm talking to someone, talking to my partner that's standing beside me. You may not see them, but I do. And the Lord says that I'm always with you. He's always with you. I don't have to get in my secret closet to honor him or to ask him for something. I could just turn to him and say, you know, Lord, you asked me to do that, and I did it, I did it, I did it. And now what are you going to do for me? Or can you carry me through this? And you know what? I walk right through. Smooth sailing. Smooth sailing. Like I said, I'm not here to get testimony this morning, so let me continue on. But I just thought that when something's heavy on your heart, you have to let someone else know. So praise God. We're going to have our scripture right now. Don't be remiss if I don't read your scripture, but as I was telling you, I was with my wife. She passed away in August 2020. She's gone for 18, 19 months now, and this was her favorite. This was her favorite song. Psalm 27. I got an updated version. I'll be reading the Scofield Study Bible. I wish I had the King James Bible. That's the one she read from. It had a beautiful 27 psalm, sound like a poem. This one is in today's language. It says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail one to eat up my flesh, my adversaries and foes, it is they who will stumble and fall. Though an army encamped against me, my heart shall not fear. The war arises against me, yet I will be confident. One thing have I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple, for he would hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He would conceal me under the cover of his tent. He would lift me high upon a rock, and now my head shall be lifted up above all my enemies all around me. And I will dwell, I will offer in his tent sacrifice with shout of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. And I'm going to read one verse more. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. You have said, seek my face. My heart say to you, your face, Lord, do I seek? Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. Or you will hear, or you who have been my help, cast me not off. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. I'll stop there. But I just want to let you know that through the beauty of the Lord giving me articulation, a voice to speak, I do a lot of things. I try to keep myself a sail of what's going on. So if you see me sometime walking around talking like I'm talking to myself, I'm not talking to myself, I'm talking to the Lord. He hears me. And I'll be turning 80 this year. And at one time I tell this story. I used to be a stutterer when I was a little kid. The way that got me out of stuttering, I used to talk to myself. Talk to yourself. You get somewhere, talk to yourself so you can hear your voice, learn how to pronounce words and so forth. And I dwell on that today, that I'm able to speak and I could stress and accent my words. Sometimes you may see me talking a lot. If you see me walking around like I'm talking to somebody, to someone, I'm talking to the Lord. He hears me all the time. But just to make things short and sweet, like I said, I'll be turning 80 this year, and I want to keep my voice. I know some people that can hardly utter a word and so forth. They try to talk, but they stutter. My way to learn from stuttering talking, you get somewhere and you talk to yourself. Learn how to pronounce your words. Stress them so you understand how they go, and you won't lose that articulation of voice. Praise God. I see that we have someone coming up. So I just want to leave you with a thought today. Don't be afraid to call upon the Lord when in trouble. And if someone is around you, call on him anyway. I do. I said, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Praise you. I give them the praise. They look at me like I said, I'm turning 80 this year. So it looks like an old man that's going nuts. I'm not going nuts. I'm talking to someone. And I just look sometime, let somebody know that, hey. So if you do that, and somebody look at you kind of strange, so I'm talking to the Lord. And if they don't believe you, they say, who do you talk to when you have to, or when you're in trouble? You know, who do you call upon? If they don't know who they do, just tell them, say, well, you could borrow my partner if you want to. His name is Jesus. Praise God. Thank you.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Nice and brisk outside, the sun is shining. It's a great day. A great day to be above ground, to be able to give God some praise, giving us another chance just to get it right. One more time to get it right. May we all stand as we have our call to worship. We will be reciting the 100th Psalm, and it should be on your monitor. Let's begin. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands.
Serve the Lord with the lands.
Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that have made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. All together. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. May we recite our mission and vision statement. To introduce, present to all people Jesus Christ, through our empowering ministries, by equipping the membership through the effective preaching and preaching of the word, to the glory of God. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Father God, we are so grateful. We thank you, God, for this day that you've allowed us to be a part of. A day, oh God, that we've never seen before and will never see again. May we take full advantage of this day, of this moment, for we know not when the skies are going to open up and you appear. So we want to be ready, oh God. We want to be ready. We want to know that it's you. Thank you, God, for this opportunity to come and fellowship and worship one with another, knowing, all God, that it's only through you that we can even breathe right now. It's only through you that got us up this morning. It's only through you that helped us make our way to the house of prayer. It's only through you, oh God, that we could stand bold and say, I love you, Jesus. I love you for all the things that you've done, for all the things you're doing right now and for all the things that you're going to do if your coming is delayed. So we give you glory, honor, and praise that as our service continues, that your spirit reigns in this place, that your spirit falls on every congregant in this place. And all those, oh God, that had a desire to be here but could not be here and are looking at us on live stream, we pray your blessings on every one of those households. We pray, oh God, that they stop what they're doing to be a part of it, not just having it on to have it on. We thank you, God, that as time goes on, Lord, that we'll be able to open up fully, that we'll be able to welcome those that we haven't seen in a while. So we give you glory, honor, and praise, God, that as the word goes forth from our pastor this morning, we thank you, God, that you're anointing him from the crown of his head to the very soles of his feet, that the message that you have imparted to his spirit will be delivered as you so desire. For we know the word, no matter who it's coming from, the word, oh God, never returns unto you void. So we thank you that if there's someone here today that does not know you, that they will listen intently to get an idea of what it is that they're missing. The peace of God, the love of God. Hallelujah, Jesus. So we commend this service to you today, God. We thank you that your spirit reigns from heart to heart and breast to breast, from pulpit to the door. But as anyone that comes through those doors are welcome with a smile, with open arms. In Jesus' name we pray as we offer this prayer. And the people of God say, amen. Amen. Our morning hymn this morning is Standing on the Promises. Yes, 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 yes. Are you standing on the promises this morning? On God's promises. You know, he does not go back on his word. And he fulfills every promise that he has made us. This time we'll have our scripture with Brother Smith, Minister Smith.
Good morning, First Baptist.
Good morning.
If you don't mind, I'd like to take this off. This morning, the scripture will be coming from Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 through 27. Matthew 7, 24 through 27. I will be reading from the English Standard Version. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
And bear with me. I'm still having vision issues. I have my glasses on today. I prefer contact lenses. My eyes were red. I saw the eye doctor. So bear with me if I stutter and stammer. Amen. Are we together?
Yes.
And it reads, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Come on, church, if you know that God is an on-time God, come on and give God some praise in this house this morning. Oh, come on, don't fool me now. If you know that God is an on-time God, Big Mama says he may not come when you want him, but when he does show up, God is right on time. Has it been on time for anyone this morning? Has it been on time to heal you? Has it been on time to give you a financial blessing? Has it been on time to open doors that no man can open? Has it been on time to rectify terrible situations? Has it been on time to comfort you as you walk through the valley of the shadow of death? Yes, he is an on-time God. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Thank you. Oh, I don't know about you. I just want to tell God, thank you this morning for being God and being God all by yourself. Hallelujah. Somebody's been through some stuff this week, but because God wasn't late, you made it through your trial and your tribulation. Come on, just lift those hands up and tell God, thank you. Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Glory. Sister Sharon, I feel like shouting a little bit this morning. Amen. I asked somebody the other day how they were feeling. They said, I'm upright. I'm vertical. I'm not horizontal. Hello, somebody. I'm able to stand up and have the use and activities of my limbs. I can put one foot in front of the other without mechanical aids. Come on, you're in here today on your own power. Hallelujah. God is an awesome God. Truly worthy to be praised. Let me first of all thank each and every one of you who have extended your prayers to me and my family in the passing of my aunt. We're grateful to God for her life and her legacy, but we're also grateful to God that he allowed us to travel over the dangerous highways and byways, seeing accidents, cars on the left and the right turned upside down, and it wasn't ours. Come on, somebody. Come on, and we were able to come back home safely. Amen. And then to get back home and then get ready to travel for our 6-month test. And I am so glad. I'm so glad that I can pronounce what the doctor said, but what God had already said. Hello, somebody. That all is well with this building. Hello, somebody. Hello. And so we just took an extra Sunday to get ourselves together. People don't understand what emotional roller coasters will do for you. And every now and then, you need to put on some brakes and just say, you know what? I just want to take a moment, catch my breath. But guess what? I'm back. Amen. I am here this morning. Amen. Amen. Let me do this. Secondly, I want to formally welcome Minister James E. Smith to the pulpit. Amen. Bless you, sir. Hallelujah. I was not here, but God saw fit to allow us to be in a traffic jam, a parking lot on 95 North, for your entire sermon. So I was not distracted. I didn't have to pull over. I was able to hear it, and what a wonderful word it was. And so, hallelujah, church. He is one of ours, and we're glad to have him in the pulpit. He's been cheering us on from the sideline, but now he's up here in the race with us, and we are grateful to God for that. And we're going to be presenting him some official documents in the next coming days, but we're just excited to have him, and I can officially welcome him to the pulpit and to our pulpit staff. Amen? Amen. Amen. Last Sunday, there was an interesting lesson in the Sunday school. And those of you who had an opportunity to tune into the Sunday school, they were talking about building on a firm foundation. Amen. And I want to piggyback on that lesson this morning because I think it is relevant for this time of the church, this ecclesiastical period of the church called Lent. that we understand that we need to have our faith built on a firm foundation. Amen. And so the question I want to raise this morning is, what is your house built on? What is your house built on? But I want to spend more time talking about the process than the building. Matthew chapter 7 that was read in your hearing, I just want to deal with verse number 26. In my version, it's read. That means this is Jesus speaking. And Jesus says, everyone who hears these words of mine, King James says, everyone who hears my words and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who builds his house on sand. I want to talk about the process. Amen. A few months ago, I was awakened very early in the morning by the sound of a pounding. It sounded like somebody was beating steel or beating a column or a pole into the ground. It woke me up because it was rhythmic. And it just kept going and going. And then there was a pause, and then it started all over again. It bothered me, but I moved on. Well, Sister Jones, the next morning, I was awakened by the same sound. And now I begin to pay attention to the sound because I now notice that every day at around the same time, about 7:45, this noise would start. And it wasn't a noise that was in the house, but it was so loud and it was so prominent that I felt that it was close. And so as the baby and I went for a walk, it was a nice day, I started walking through the community following this sound because the sound went all day long till about 3:30, 4 o'clock, then it stopped. I first thought it was my neighbor up the street because she's got some renovations going on in her house. And I said, man, they got these carpenters out here early in the morning banging these hammers and nails. But this particular morning, they were not there, but the sound was. And so I started following the sound. And the sound took me around my normal route, which is around here and around the church, and I couldn't see it, but I could still hear it. And the closer I got to 2nd Avenue, Minister Smith, the louder it got. And I could tell it was coming from down that way. So I proceeded to get in my car and ride over there because I wanted to know what this sound was. And for those of you who are not aware, they have torn down Toro College. And they're in the process of building a new building. And the sound that I was hearing was them pounding steel columns down into the ground. Now, I'd seen this process before, and I understood what it was, but it was just so profound to me, I had to sit there and I had to watch it. And they were just pounding these steel beams down into the ground. And yesterday when I drove by there, I could see the tops of all of these steel beams that they had put down in the ground. And they had now poured concrete on the top of them. And I began to ask myself a question. Why did they go through all of this trouble of driving these pylons down in the ground? It seemed like to me about every 2 to 4 feet apart. It's a million of them out there. I understood that they were preparing the foundation for the building that they're going to build. And then, I began to think about it, began to research, and I know Deacon Martin's here. He's an engineer. He understands all of this stuff. But because we live on an island, there's water. And if you don't build a proper and sturdy and solid foundation, your building is eventually going to. So they've put all of these steel columns down in the ground and poured cement around them so that when they start building, they've got a solid foundation to build that building on. Well, that's a visual example of what Jesus is talking about in this text. See, because it's really about our faith. This parable is really about our faith, or the faith of the individuals who are listening to Jesus. It's really not about building a building. Even though he says there's two men and one built a house on a rock and the other one built it on sand. But Jesus is really talking about what foundation is your faith built on? Jesus asked the question another way later on in Matthew when he asked his disciples, who do men say that I am? And they said, well, you know, some of them think you're a good man. Some say that today. Some say that you're one of the prophets of old. Matter of fact, some of them say you might even be Elijah come back from the dead. He said, okay, that's good, but what do you say? Whom do you say I am? The ones who have been with me, that have heard what I've had to say, saw what I was able to do, what are you saying about me? You see, that's the real question as it relates to this faith that we have in Jesus. What is your faith saying about Jesus? Oh, it got quiet. See, when we look at this parable, there's a direct correlation between what we believe and what we do. Jesus says, if anyone hears these words of mine and do them or act upon them, then they shall be like a wise man that when he went to build his house, he built his house on a rock and not on sand. This parable is so powerful when we really understand that Jesus is talking about our faith and where our faith lies. And I just want to share with you this morning from three aspects or three points as it relates to this process of our faith building. If you're going to build anything, whether it be natural or spiritual, you must first start off with examination or observation. See, the developers looked all around Bayshore and tried to find the proper space to build this building. And they concluded the Toro College space was adequate. It was big enough. It was wide enough. It was deep enough that they could do what they wanted to do. But then they had to go in and take some core samples. They had to study the ground. Hello, somebody. They had to see what was down there. Because once they knew Deacon Martin what was down there, then they could contact the construction engineers so the engineers could put a plan together so they could build an adequate foundation that was going to hold the building that they were going to build on top of it. See, if you're going to build something, you first need to examine it. Just don't take what somebody says. Pick up the book and read it for yourself. See, if your faith is going to be stable, it's got to be built on a firm foundation. Listen, I love Big Mama. Big Mama's gone on to be with glory, but I can't live on Big Mama's faith. At some point, I've got to establish my own faith in Jesus Christ because it is a personal relationship. Listen, there's this political term when they deal with the major elections and the president's election. It's called the coattail effect. Well, it used to be called the coattail effect. We don't have the big lever anymore, so there's no such thing as a coattail because now we're voting individually for everybody. But back in the day, it was a coattail effect. We would go in there because they knew we couldn't read. And so we were taught to just pull the big lever. And we pulled the big lever, we voted everybody in the party. Hello, if we pushed Democratic lever, we voted for all of the Democrats. And those people who were less popular would jump on the coattail and fly right on into office. Hello, you're not going to get to heaven on somebody else's faith coattail. You've got to be able to stand on your own two feet. Preach, Pastor Clark. Jesus said, listen, if you're going to be smart about this thing, you got to hear what I'm saying. We've got to do some examination. Where are we in our relationship with Jesus Christ? Even more so than that, we need to ask an even deeper question. Why am I here? Why am I here? First of all, why am I physically here? Am I here because this was Mama's church? And I don't want Mama and Auntie and all them folk to get mad at me, so I'm just going to keep on going. Hello, somebody. I was talking to, listening to the young man on Tuesday at the funeral on Wednesday, talking about him and his brother coming to church, and they got sidetracked by the First Baptist Church of Carvel. And I was talking to a young man yesterday who's, we're coming up on a funeral this week, and he was saying, you know, I remember coming to First Baptist Church. I remember my mama bringing me. I remember growing up, and nobody knows me by my name. They know me by my nickname. Hello, somebody. See, why are we here? At some point, we've got to be here because we've come to know Jesus as our own Lord and Savior. We've got to walk with him. We can't go on what somebody else says about Jesus. Oh, Jesus, you're a good person. You're a prophet. You're a healer. But Jesus says, what are you saying about me? And you've got to examine, what are you saying? Not only what are you saying out of your mouth, but what are you saying by your words and your actions? See, because there's a direct correlation between what we believe and what we do. There's examination. We've got to examine this place. We've got to examine this situation where we want to build our faith. And is it a solid foundation, or do we have to do some things to make something that is unstable stable? See, whether you drive pylons down in the ground or you pour a cement slab, you need to present a solid level foundation. Hello, somebody. The other thing that you need to understand in this examination, you got to understand the climate. The natural climate. See, if you live where I used to live up in Buffalo, where there's more winter than summer. Hello. The frost level has a lot of significance. See, because you build on top of the ground that's frozen during the winter, and then it thaws out in the summer, it's going to compress when it thaws out. So what do you have to do? You got to go and you got to dig all that stuff away. You got to get below the frost line. Hello, somebody. But you've got to understand the conditions. Oh, I want to join First Baptist Church. Well, do you really know all the conditions? Let's first of all start off by saying ain't none of us perfect. No matter whether you go to First Baptist, Second Baptist, or Last Baptist. Nobody in here is perfect. The only person that's perfect is Jesus. That's the firm foundation. So I'm building my faith not on individuals around me, but I'm building my faith on the words of Jesus Christ. Because not only will people fail me, I will also fail myself. But Jesus will never fail. So in this process, there must be some examination. And then after you examine things and you realize what you have to do, you move to the second point in the process, and that's excavation. There's some stuff that needs to be removed. Hello, somebody. See, this time of Lent is really about examination. And when you find some things that are in you that should not be, you need to make some adjustments. Sunday school was talking today about the lust of the flesh and how that manifests in sexual sins. Hello, somebody. And we talk about this complacency that happens in the church, that we do whatever we want to do because we got this safety net called grace and mercy. And so we go ahead and sin, and then we run to God and ask God for forgiveness. Like Minister Smith, he said, you know what? There is no pre-repentance. Prepentance. God, I know I'm going to sin, so go ahead and forgive me. And the other word that I find so prominent in the Baptist church, and has been around for a long time, that people will do stuff and the first thing they will say is, well, God knows my heart. Yeah, that's a positive, but it's also a negative. Yeah, God does know your heart. He does know you. And you got to be careful. And I don't think it was pushed hard enough this morning. We've got to understand, even though we have this safety net called grace and mercy and forgiveness, there's also consequences. And if you read all of the scripture, you keep doing this stuff, you're going to have to deal with God. Hello, somebody. There's no free pass in this thing just because you say, Father, forgive me. My daddy put it this way. You go out there and make your bed hard, you're going to have to lie in it at the end of the day. God's not going to do for you what you can do for yourself. God's not going to correct your wrongs. Hello, somebody. You're going to have to deal with them. You're going to have to live with them, and you're going to have to make some adjustments. So in this examination part, you're going to find some stuff that needs to be removed in your life. We don't sing this song anymore in the church, and some of the senior saints that are here will remember the song. We used to sing a song that simply says, search me. Search me, Lord. Let the light from heaven shine on me. If you find anything that shouldn't be, see, I know some people know it. Take it out and straighten me. Strengthen me, straighten me. That was a song that we sang, and people sang it with passion because that's what they wanted Jesus to do. And the light of God is the word of God. And if we're not spending time with the word of God and meditating on it, then the light ain't shining. And so if the light ain't shining, I'm not seeing what I'm supposed to be seeing. Hello, somebody. Or I'm not acknowledging what I'm seeing in my life. If you want to build on a solid, firm faith foundation, there's got to be some examination. Nobody is perfect. No, not one. Paul tells the Corinthian church, let a man examine himself. Well, if you go through the examination, come on, if you done gone through all the trouble of getting up, making your way to the doctor, getting in there, waiting for them to call you to tell you to come in, you get in the room, they take your vitals, and they don't take clothes off anymore. You used to have to take clothes off, put their little gown on, and they come in, and they would examine you, and after they examine you and take all the tests, they tell you what's wrong. And they make a prognosis about your condition. Now, you have a choice. You can go and do nothing. Or you can follow the doctor's advice. Now, beloved, if you've gone through all of the trouble of going through the examination, and some of them are very evasive, hello, somebody, then you ought to glean from the examination. See, on Sunday morning, when you come to church, it's an examination process. The word of God is presented, and the word of God is to convict us. In other words, it shows us ourselves. Listen, we shouldn't come to church just to be able to holler and shout and run around the church. Sometimes we wind up crying because the word of God exposes us. See, excavation is about exposing. It's about removing some stuff so that we can get down to what is called bedrock, solid foundation. Getting to the core of who we are and our belief systems. What do we believe about Jesus? The Bible says that we are saved because we confess Jesus as Lord and Savior. When Jesus asked them who they were, it was Big Mouth Peter. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, you know what, Peter? You're right. But flesh and blood didn't reveal that unto you. You couldn't even come up with that on your own. My Father, which is in heaven, revealed that unto you. And on that statement, not on Peter, but on that statement, I will build my faith. I'll build my church. In this examination and investigating a process where you've moved all of this ancillary stuff, because we got a whole lot of fluff in our lives. We pack a whole lot of stuff in there. We got a whole lot of busyness. You ask people, how you doing? Well, I'm just busy. You're just busy doing what? I don't mean that critical. Listen, the only thing that matters is what we do for Christ. That's what the Bible says. And if we got this business and we're running here and there, running, doing this, talking on the phone, gossiping, ain't none of that about Christ. And if we're built on a firm foundation, which is Jesus Christ, then everything that ought to come out of us ought to be synonymous with what we believe. If it's not, we got to dig it up and get rid of it. So there's examination. There's excavation. Got to move some stuff away. I don't know if you saw them, but in that process over there, they had piles of dirt. piles of dirt. They just move. And so I said, where'd they bring all that dirt from? No, they didn't bring it from nowhere. They got it from there. They just pushed all the topsoil up so they could get down to a place where they could start building. Hello, somebody. Is your building, is your faith on a firm or solid foundation? When you've done the examination and you've done the investigation and you've excavated that stuff that's not going to be able to hold your faith or the foundation of your building, when you move that, then you can start building. And that's elevation. Hallelujah, somebody. We can start building when our lives and our faith is built on a firm foundation. See, when Jesus uses parable about these two builders, the one builder built his house on a rock. Watch this. The other one built his on sand. Well, who's to say that there's not a rock somewhere underneath that sand? But because he didn't go through the proper process to move that sand out the way, because it will shift and get down to a solid foundation, he just said, look, I ain't got the time to do all that. That's too much work. We're trying to take the shortcut, the path of least resistance. We're just going to build it right here on the sand. Well, whether you realize it or not, in both situations, wind, rain, and storms came. And I need to help you understand this morning, and maybe some of you will shout, if you haven't had them, keep living. Some winds, some rain, and some storms are going to come in your life, and particularly in your faith. There were things that will happen that will test and try your faith. I don't care how holy you seem to be, how long you've been in the church, none of us are exempt from trials, tests, and tribulations in our lives. Am I talking to anybody in here? Has anybody been through some trial and test in your life, and it has tried your faith? How many times have you questioned God and said, God, why me? I was talking to a young lady the other day. She said, Pastor, I just can't deal with this. I lost a brother. I lost an uncle. I lost an aunt. And now I lost another brother all in the last year and a half. Why me, God? Come on, y'all. Let's be real. We do ask these questions of God.
Well, you know, we can't question God.
Job did, and he didn't die. Matter of fact, Job went to God with an argument. His lips was tight when he went to God. Hello, somebody. And can I just be a little transparent? About 4 years ago, I was in the same situation. I'm like, God, I've been faithful to you for all of these many years. I put up a whole bunch of stuff from your people. And this is how you pay me? Come on, y'all. If we're not going to be real in church, then we already built on a sandy foundation. God, I know I'm not perfect, but I tried to do what I needed to do to please you. And this is what you give me, this report? And God says, okay. But my grace. In the midst of your tight-lippedness, in the midst of your blood running warm, my grace is still sufficient, because I could have allowed them, as they did all of the months before, to miss what was going on in your body. I could have allowed it, but I revealed it so that they could deal with it. See, God will reveal some stuff in your life to really show you where your faith is. The songwriter said, if I didn't have a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve them. If I wasn't sick, I wouldn't know that God could heal me. But guess what? I got a new testimony. I got a new song because of what I've been through. And it has strengthened my foundation. See, every now and then you got to put an addition on your house. See, as your family grows, you got to build an addition on your house. Your house gets a little too small. Your faith is a little too small, and you've got to expand it. That's what happened in Job's situation. He had some trials in his life, and yes, he trusted God. He ran away from evil, but his faith was really, 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 really not strong enough to deal with stuff. And here he is sitting in an ash heap questioning his walk with God. But God's response was, Job, where were you when I created everything that I created? Where were you when I gave life to the dewdrop? Where were you when I painted the grass green? Hello, somebody. Where were you when I gave and wrote the score for the robin to sing? Where were you? See, we were not around when God was doing what God doing. And God said it this way, your ways are not my ways and my thoughts are not your thoughts. You're not going to be able to understand what I'm doing, but if you accept it, you'll make it through whatever you're going through. And David says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. See, you don't realize it, but I'm already in the elevation part. See, when your faith is built on Jesus, you can build some stuff in your life, and your faith can be built up so that when the storms come, when the winds come, when the rains come, they're going to beat on your faith. They're going to beat on your life. They're going to beat on your family. But if your faith is built on a solid rock, the storms will come and you'll say, come on, storm, I'm just going to refer you. When you go into a place with a complaint, we go in and we start dealing with the little people instead of we should go in and ask for the management. Elder Bell, I feel like shouting right there. So, somebody just missed out. Listen, I got to bypass some folk because I need to go upstairs. There's some problems going on in my life. And the only person that can handle this, you might be able to take the report. You might be able to write it down, but you're going to have to take that report upstairs. See, that's what I like about the Protestant religion. I'm not here to bash anybody else's religion, but I like the fact that you don't have to come to me. And I don't have to go to you. We can bypass the middle person. And we can go right to God. And we can go right to God. And we can express our concerns, our cares in the way that we express them. And the God that we serve won't send a bolt of lightning and blow us off the face of the earth. But God will allow us to talk to God right where we are. Is there anybody here to know what I'm talking about? See, because God wants to lift us. God wants to elevate us. God wants to strengthen us. God wants us to get into a place where we can lift God up. Excavation. Examination, excavation, and elevation. If we're going to deal with this process, we need to understand that although there will be some external evidence of the process starts on the inside. Hello, somebody. If thou wilt confess with thy mouth and believe in thy heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Both of those are internal. The Sunday school lesson this morning talked about sins outside of the body and sins within the body. Faith happens within the body. It happens at the core of who we are. And if we want to understand and know and have the blessed assurance that we can make it through trials and tribulations, we've got to make sure that our faith, the core of our belief, is built on a solid, firm, level foundation. Now, as I close, this is where it becomes complicated. It becomes complicated from a worldview because our faith is built on the fact that our Savior was crucified. The very foundation, the very core of our belief is in a human being, God manifested in the flesh in a person called Jesus who was killed by the will of other men. Hello, somebody. You've got to understand this, because this is how our religion or our beliefs are attacked by other people. How is your faith built on a dead God? That's what they're saying, because our images, depending on what churches you go to, and I heard somebody say just a couple weeks ago, every time I go into church, I see all these images, these idols of a dead Jesus hanging on the cross. Well, yeah, that is a symbol of the reality of our faith, but it's not the only symbol of the reality of our faith. It is a symbol in the process of our faith. Yes, he died. Yes, he was buried. And whether you believe it or not, we choose to believe it that on the third day, you see it? He got up. And because he got up, he also raises us up. He says, if you suffer with Christ and you die with Christ and you're buried with Christ, you will also be risen or raised with Christ. I may be down right now, but I'm coming up. I may be going through some stuff. I may be low. I may be depressed. But can anybody holler in this morning? I'm coming up. I'm coming up. I'm coming out of this situation. I'm coming out of this funk. I'm coming out of this fog. I'm coming out of COVID. I'm coming out of death and destruction. I'm being raised to life everlasting. See, what they don't realize is the very thing that they're concentrating on as a detriment to our faith is really a commendation of our faith. Because watch this. I can really appreciate the elevation because I've had some excavation. I can really understand and appreciate the mountaintop because I've been in the valley. I wish I had some help in here. I wish I had some valley folk in here this morning that you don't mind expressing your praise unto God for your valley experiences, because you've come to understand my life would not be what it is today if you took those valley experiences out of my life. If you took those times out where I had to go on public assistance, if you took those times out where I was driving on fumes in a little old buggy trying to get to a job that I didn't like and work with people that I couldn't stand just to get a check at the end of the day that didn't meet my needs. But oh, look where I am right now. When I see my mama and my grandmama and my foreparents down on their knees scrubbing bathroom floors and cleaning up for folk, I now can get up because they were down. I wish I had some help in here this morning. There's just a couple of folk that want to pray. Praise God and thank God for the excavation. Thank God that he took away, he tore away, he dug up some stuff in your life so that now you who were buried, now you who were dead, now you who were down can now jump up on your feet, throw back your hands, open up your mouth and tell God, thank you. Paul said it this way, that I have learned that whatever situation, listen, I get excited about the learn, because we miss lessons in life. Lessons don't come easy. Lessons come because of trials and tribulations. But a professor told me not too long ago, a real lesson comes when you fail, but you're able to get back up again. Y'all don't hear me in here. See, what have you learned from the failures in your life? If you go back and you do the same thing, guess what you've learned? Absolutely nothing. You missed the lesson. But when you fall, and you get back up, you learn that that is a trip hazard. And so when you get to it again, you step over it or you go around it. Hello, somebody. Have you had to go around some stuff in your life? Listen, you start walking down that road. I'm trying to get to my seat, Sister Jones. But when you go down the road and you say, wait a minute, I've been here before. I know what this looks like. I know the result of this. I ain't going down this way no more. I'm going a different way. Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you for a firm foundation. Let me just give you this little bit. And seriously. The building of our faith is never complete down here on this earth. As long as we're in this flesh, we are continuing to add to our faith daily. As long as we keep reading, studying, praying, and let me just throw this one in for extra, trying. Trying. I'm striving. I'm reaching for perfection. I ain't there yet, but I'm reaching for it. I'm trying. I'm going to have some slips. I'm going to have some falls along the way, but I am still. Hallelujah. And as I continue to try, my faith is getting stronger each and every day. We're going to have, Jesus says, in this life, you will have trial and tribulation. But know this, I have overcome them all. If your faith is built on Jesus Christ, you too, my brother, you too, my sister, can overcome the trials and tribulations in your life. I wish you would just declare this morning, I am an overcomer. Turn to somebody else and say, my brother, my sister, you should be an overcomer. Are there any overcomers in the place today? I can overcome because my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Anybody standing on the solid rock today? I said, is there anybody here standing on the solid rock? Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is our solid rock. Jesus Christ is our hope. Jesus Christ is our all in all. If Jesus is your rock, come on, give him some praise this morning. Come on, give God some praise in this place. Hallelujah. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Come on, church. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking. When darkness veils, darkness veils his lonely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every dark and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the. Oh, Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. When he shall come, when he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Come on, Christ, let rock I stand, oh, love. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, bless your name, God. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your word, Father God, in this day and this place. We pray even now, Lord God, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart has been acceptable in your sight.
Building on. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank God for the message this morning. Thank God for the messenger. How it went forth with power in the name of Jesus. At this time, we will extend an invitation to that one or two or three that does not know you, Lord, that wants to start the process. And without the process, you have to be able to accept the Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Jesus.
Step number one, accept the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life. And if you have not done that, you have an opportunity right now. No matter where you are, on live stream or in the building, you have this opportunity because you do not know. None of us know when our last breath is going to be. So while you have the chance, while you have the opportunity, say yes to the Lord. To start this process of building your faith, getting it on a strong foundation, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. So we extend an invitation to you. In the name of Jesus.
Yes, now.
Hallelujah.
Come to Jesus, my brother.
Come to Jesus.
Come to
Jesus. Come to Jesus. Just now. Come to Right now. Hallelujah. He will save you. He will save you. With all that was talked about this morning, you need him. You need him. Hallelujah. Is there one today? I'm confessing. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come as a candidate for baptism. You may come under Christian Experience. You may come by letter or restoration. But just come. Praise God. Is there one today? Thank Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Praise, praise, praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, if you're saved and you know it, oh, glory, 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 glory. Thank you, Jesus.
We have, at this time, get ready to get up and start dancing. Our sister Sharonda has received Jesus as her Lord and Savior. She is now a candidate for baptism. Hallelujah to our Lord. Another soul has come in. The angels in heaven are dancing. They're shouting. They're celebrating. So what should we be doing? Hallelujah. Yes. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Praise our Lord. Our sister Sharonda has received Jesus as her Lord and Savior. Deacons, what are your pleasure concerning our dear sister?
How is she coming? How is she coming? Church, I move at this time that we accept Sister Sharonda as a candidate for baptism. And after having attended new members class, receiving the right hand fellowship, become a full-fledged member of First Baptist Church.
It's been moved and seconded that we receive our dear sister, and after new members class, being baptized and receiving the right hand of fellowship, become a full-fledged member of First Baptist Church of Bayshore. Church, what is your pleasure? What do you say about that? Hallelujah! 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 Hallelujah. Sister Sharonda, please follow us.
Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You know, the angels are shouting. The angels are shouting. We thank God for this young person who has come forth to give her life. And who needs it more than our young people right now? So we thank God that we embrace her as she takes this step, because we know that the devil is busy. So we praise God for her, and we will be praying for her as she goes through this process. We'll now have our announcements and our altar prayer, and then our announcement.
Let us bow our heads. Lord God, our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for being so good to us, Lord God. We thank you for your grace and for your mercy, Lord God. We thank you for each one of our family members. Lord God, we pray for our loved ones that they would know you in the pardon of their sins, that they would know you, Lord God, intimately, for you came to knock on each of our doors. So we pray for our loved ones that they will open up the door and let you in. We pray for those, Lord God, that cannot make it to the altar at this time, Lord God. We pray for those, Lord, who are in the hospitals, those who are in the nursing homes. We pray for those who are incarcerated, Lord God. We pray for those who are lonely and homeless. Lord, at this time, we just lift them up. We lift up, Lord God, our emeritus deacons and deaconesses. Lord God, we lift up our jewels where they are at this time. Lord, because geographically there is no distance between you and our hearts, Lord God. So we lift them up to you. We lift up those families, Lord God, that are going through bereavement, going through the valley of the shadow of death. Lord God, we know that you're the only one that can console a bereaved heart, Lord God. So we lift up all of those families, Lord God, who are suffering bereavement. Lord God, we lift up the citizens of Ukraine at this time, Lord God, that are being killed, bombs are dropping on their heads, Lord God. They're leaving their homes and their country, Lord God. Devastation is facing them everywhere, Lord God. So we just lift them up. And we lift up, Lord God, that country of Russia for doing it all. Lord God, we know that prayer touches your heart, and then you move your hand. So we intercede for all of those, Lord God, who cannot make it to the altar at this time. Have your way with them. This we pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And amen. At this time, our announcements are as follows. Those of you who remember our dear sister, Marcia Clopton, she has passed, and her funeral will be at Roses this Wednesday, the viewing from 7 to 9, and Thursday morning here at First Baptist Church. So we're lifting up the Clopton family. The Penetiquot Creek planting and weed removal will be going on again right here in our own backyard at April 9th from 9 a.m. to 12 noon. So volunteers are needed to remove the invasive plants and to plant down the ones that pollinate and restore the beauty of nature around the Penetiquot Creek. We have an announcement here. The Town of Islip Department of Parks, Recreation, and Cultural Affairs is hiring. Starting salary is $15 an hour. There are walk-in interviews on Saturday, March 6, 11 through, and June, that one was, we know yesterday, right? But Wednesday, June 1st, from 3 to 7 at Brookwood Hall. The telephone number is here available if anyone needs it. Suffolk County Community College is having an open house April 3rd from 12 noon to 3 p.m. to all of those who are interested can come forth. Deacon Jones.
I know what y'all are saying. He's saying, there he is again. Yeah, that's right, I am. For the last time. Because next Sunday, we are going to celebrate the 10th year of our pastor's anniversary. We've been planning this thing for a few months now, and we've given you an opportunity, all of those who would want to join us, that you might come and join us in this celebration. But time has run out, and we cannot take any more money or people signing up after today, because we don't want to be at the door trying to count money or figure out if you paid or whatever. We want to have all that done when we get there. And we just want to sit down and enjoy with our pastor. Celebrate with him this 10th anniversary. So all of those who have not finished paying, we ask that you would please do so today. Sister Maylane, Deaconess Maylane, has been sitting in the back of the church there every Sunday, waiting. And she'll be there today for the last time. Please join us on next Sunday as we celebrate this big day. Admission is $60 for a ticket. Children, $27. And so we thank you for knowing that you're going to want to be there. Now, those of you who cannot join us at Captain Bill's, if you cannot join us at Captain Bill's, we've asked that you bring your gifts that you will have for our pastor on next Sunday morning. Bring them on Sunday morning. You're going to see some deacons standing here holding a box. Please put your gifts in those boxes, not on the table. Also, if you have checks, make them out to Pastor Darius Dixon Clark, not the First Baptist Church. Those of you who have gifts for the pastor, bring them, and you cannot join us at Captain Bill's, bring them next Sunday morning and place them in the boxes that we'll have available for you. Those of you who are our auxiliaries, our ministers or whatever, who will be joining us at Captain Bill's, we have an opportunity there. But if you cannot, please bring them Sunday morning, okay? Thank you very much, and we look forward to seeing you next Sunday afternoon at Captain Bill's.
We thank Deacon Jones for that announcement. And on next Sunday, while we're celebrating, Pastor Washington, president of the Empire State Convention, will be the preacher, the guest preacher. So at this time, Pastor will come with further announcement.
I don't know about y'all, but I just want to give God a hand clap of praise for just being God and being God all by himself. It does not seem like 10 years. It does not seem like 10 years. And I just thank God that we have been here and God has been faithful. Amen? Amen. Amen. I do have a couple of announcements I do want to share with you. I received an email this week about one of our young people. And the email was a very positive email. We see so much negativity in the news and in the community about our young people. But many of you will know our young brother, Cameron. Cameron is 8 years old, Sister Daphne Somerville's grandson. We're excited because he has been involved in the Lincoln Center production. God is allowing him through his gifts and skills and talents, especially with the piano, to be part of this production at the Lincoln Center. It just comes to me as a word, an acknowledgement of Cameron and all that he is doing. Many of us remember little Cameron, but I looked at his picture on the website, and I didn't recognize him. Because he's grown up. He's 8 years old and doing some wonderful things. And we thank God for him and all of our young people that are doing positive things, coming up on their senior year, some graduating, some being promoted in the next couple of months. And we commend them and congratulate them on their accomplishments. They don't all come to me, but y'all know. And we want to encourage and lift up our young people in all of their accomplishments. Because if we're not praising them, amen. Y'all know the rest of that. Amen. 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 Come on. Come on. Upcoming events that you should note for those of you who fall in these categories: on Monday, April 4th, we will have a leadership meeting here at the church at 6 o'clock, and then an official board meeting at 7 o'clock. That's Monday, April 4th. Also on April 10th, if you don't know, it is Palm Sunday. We will have palms here for those who come to the church. And then we will also facilitate trying to get some out to our sick and our shut in. On April 11th, we will have our church business meeting here in the sanctuary per the order of our official board. We're now starting to move back into some of our church activities and our church events. But again, we will still have our face mask policy in effect when you come into the church. And for all of our leaders, it's very important that you attend the meeting on April 4th, because there's some things that you need to know as it relates to your ministry meetings here at the church and how we are going to coordinate those and conduct those. On April 14th, which is Maundy Thursday, come on, y'all. Resurrection Sunday is right around the corner. Amen. On April 14th, we will have our Maundy Thursday service. It will be both here in the sanctuary and live stream. All of our ministers, including our newest minister. Amen. And we will have a guest pastor with us. Pastor Mosley will be here, and we will have our Maundy Thursday service. We will not have the washing of feet, but we will serve communion. Amen. And so we're looking forward to all of you to come and be a part of it and hear what God is going to say through all of our ministers. Also on that Friday, which is Good Friday service, our youth will be here at the church at 7 o'clock reenacting the Last Supper. Amen, somebody. Amen. So you want to come and support our young people as they reenact the Lord's Supper on Good Friday night. And then on April 17th, which is Resurrection Sunday morning, we will have a sunrise service. Let me say it one more time. We will have a sunrise service. Amen. 5 a.m. We will be here early at the tomb to declare that Jesus is risen. He's risen indeed.
And then we will have our normal 9:45 service, Resurrection Sunday service. Please take note of those dates and those events. We will have a listing that you can carry with you next Sunday so that you can have these dates and be aware of upcoming events in the church. We're going to try to move back into some semblance of normal as we can. But in the meantime, please, my brother, please, my sisters, be in prayer one for another. As I know, I don't know it's either 10 or 11 because we have not confirmed that with the funeral home, but we do know it's going to be on Thursday. So we will try to get the word out as soon as we can, either 10 or 11. 4:30. All right. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Did y'all have a good time in service today? Hallelujah. Well, if you didn't, I did. Amen. Hallelujah. I enjoy watching God do what God does. Amen. And I pray that you have been blessed and lifted up. As spring is breaking on the outside and stuff that has been dormant all winter long is beginning to make its way through the ground. I think I said to somebody last week, they talk about how gloomy it is and how dark it is and the rain. You got to understand the rain loosens up the ground and nourishes those bulbs and things that are in the ground. It's like an alarm clock. It wakes them up so that they can begin to come forth. God is creating a spring in your life right now. We have been through the dark, dismal days of COVID-19. Spring is now coming. Amen. Spring is now coming in the lives of God's people, and we ought to be able to give God some honor, glory, and praise. We've lost some friends. We've lost some neighbors. We lost some co-workers, but we haven't lost our joy. We haven't lost our praise. Come on, y'all. We're still giving God praise, honor, and glory. Is that everything? Is that everything? Let us stand to our feet. Amen. As we prepare to go down from this place, we're grateful to God what our eyes have seen, what our ears have heard, but most importantly, what our spirits have felt. And I don't know about you, but I feel good. I feel good down in my soul. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for the privilege of being physically here in the worship experience. We thank you, Lord God, that even though we have some that can't physically be here in the sanctuary, they're able to join us. These are the blessing of technology. Lord, we know that although they're not physically here, you are everywhere. And you're in their living rooms, God. You're in their kitchens. You're in their bedrooms. You're in their family rooms. You're in their basements. You're in their homes, Lord God. You're in their cars. Wherever they're listening to us right now, you're there, oh God. And we ask, Lord God, in a special way that you would bless them, that you would birth this word into their spirit, Lord God, that they will begin to rise up, hallelujah, and give you praise. We thank you, God. For everyone under the sound of my voice, thank you for the ministers, the musicians, the sound techs, the trustees, the ushers, hallelujah, the nurses, the security people, and all of your people that came to give you worship, honor, and praise today. We pray, Father God, that you would bless the offering that's going to be received. You said in your word, bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be meat in mine house, saith the Lord. Near First Baptist, God, we put our offerings in our right hand because we want to give you what's and not what's. For when we give you what's, you've promised that you would bless what's left. So God, we say thank you. God, we bless you. God, we honor you. God, we praise you now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, to present us faultless before his divine majesty, be power, dominion, and peace from henceforth and forevermore.
Let the redeemed of the Lord sing. Sections A and Section C, won't you come? And after they've come, Section B. May God's richest blessings abound in your life.